much for all of those undeserved compliments. We hope to justify a little bit during my talk. It's a great pleasure to be here. It's an unexpected pleasure to see all these students, and you know, I will be talking about mathematics. I'll be also talking about other things. Samuel suggested that I talk a little bit about perspectives for young people in Europe, just to somehow compare how it is here, how it's there, and maybe to make some collaborative effort. So there will be something for everybody. There will be some proofs for those of you who like proofs in set theory, but there won't be too many, so those who do not, but who are not in the subject, do not feel that you will be overwhelmed by this. My talk is actually made longer than what I, my actual talk will be 50 minutes or so. But my slides are for 90 minutes because I wanted to present more so that Samuel can put this on his website or something so students could consult the details that you will not have time to cover in the talk. So don't be scared about none of those slides. We'll maybe not go through them. Okay. So the plan of the talk is to give you some ideas of open problems in set theory. If I understand correctly, you have now the honor of being the first Bahian university that can offer PhDs in mathematics. So this is a really excellent and exciting moment. So I thought it might be good for those who are thinking about the PhD to hear what are open problems in mathematics in this domain. Okay, but you know, first things first. Let me first thank you, beautiful country, for welcoming me here. And there are pictures of some of my favorite Brazilians. There are, of course, many others. This is a certain architect that has been in Brasilia, but is also built, perhaps not so much known in Brazil. He also built many things in France, including the building in Bobigny, okay, which you might see every day in your life. And of course, government, which I am very much admirative of. So President Lula and his successor Dilma, I think everybody in Europe is looking very much up to Brazil these days. Very happy to see all the positive things that are happening in the economy and so forth. And he is the picture of Gilberto Gil, whom I had the honor of listening to in person in one of his concerts in Nice. Okay, so I want to talk now to the students who are thinking about taking up a PhD project. So when you take a PhD project, you have many directions you can take. One direction is you can just listen to what your advisor tells you. This is usually not a bad idea, but it's not the best idea, because I think you should somehow choose an element, not just take the first thing that is going up to you. So it's a good idea to look around a little bit, possibly with the advisor, ask a few questions, and then decide. So you might ask some philosophical questions first, like what is a good taste when you want to do mathematics? Why do you choose a certain topic? So everybody has their own opinions, and of course I can only tell you my opinion. My opinion is that an interesting mathematical problem should have several elements. First, it should be well motivated. So just because somebody told me this is an interesting problem, this is not a motivation. It's a very funny problem. One should actually find some mathematical motivation coming from more than one source, idea. And I think that mathematics is very much the basis of many things. Our domain is the foundations of mathematics. So I think we should also be working on things that have some philosophical significance in the context of foundations of mathematics, of course. And also some aesthetic significance. So I don't think one should be producing theorems which are unreadable and these statements nobody but the author could understand. So you should be working on a problem, we should all be working on a problem that is interesting to the mathematical community. So that's what I listed as the next thing. It should have an interest beyond an immediate circle of followers. You know, if it is just you and two friends around the world who are interested in this subject, it's bad news. It is not ideal. And finally, one has to admit mathematics is a bit of a sport. So you don't want to be working on a theorem that your first door neighbor can solve in 5 minutes. You know, there is a little bit of competition. You want to feel good after you have done your theorem. So that's basically the things that one should be. So with this in mind, we shall discuss three groups of problems. You know, I will be talking about set theory. There are many groups of problems in set theory. I don't want to talk about one open problem, but about areas that are interesting in set theory. And there are many that one can choose to discuss. And I chose three large areas. Probably we won't have time to go into all three of them. I chose them for my personal taste. I had something to say about them. But there are some interesting open questions, the main open questions in set theory that will be mentioned, and some smaller questions also, which is a good thing that one looks for a problem, one shouldn't look just one question, but somehow at the body of research. So I'll try to represent some that interest me. So since we are in set theory, I think we should start by reminding ourselves what is set theory good about, why we're doing this subject. So first, set theory has both mathematical and foundational aspects. It was discovered as part of mathematics. Cantor discovered it in 1878 about, and he was not at all interested in foundations of mathematics. He was working on trigonometric series. Now, that was analysis, very nice classical analysis. He was looking at the convergence of certain series and defined a set of uniqueness. But then, because of the Hilbert program, which was the program at that time in mathematics. Mathematics was very optimistic at that time. And people had a lot of success axiomatizing various parts of mathematics. Hilbert, for example, gave a complete list of axioms for geometry, including those axioms of Euclid, for Euclidean geometry. And, you know, that was the feeling that we actually can axiomatize mathematics. So this Hilbert program was born out of that, and set theory was taken by Hilbert himself as a way to formalize mathematics. Because everything, or almost everything, certainly what people are looking at the time, can be represented as a set. And so what's also interesting about set theory is that these two things, the foundational and the mathematical aspects, meet very often. I find this very fascinating. So, as I said, Cantor's set theory was regarded by Hilbert as a way to obtain a consistent and complete foundation of mathematics. There were certain other requirements. There were 5 requirements. These were the first 2 requirements of the Hilbert problem. Okay, well, this was a very nice time. Optimistic, everybody thinks that we can solve everything. You know, 19th century belief in science and progress. Things changed a little bit in the 20th century. So the first thing about set theory that some paradoxes started appearing at the end of the 19th century due to Russell and Cantor. For example, everybody knows the Russell's paradox, which shows that you cannot have the set of all sets. So to resolve these problems, it was necessary to have proper foundations of set theory itself. Forget mathematics, just set theory. And it took some time. So the system that we use now is due to Zermelo-Frankel, approximately 1920s. It took some time to formulate. The C here is not the man, it's the choice. So we use the Zermelo-Frankel axioms with choice. It's the usual formalization of mathematics in set theory. Set theory, I want to say, there are others, but this one has shown to be, I think, most robust and most useful in mathematics. Some were proposed also by Hilbert, by other people, Bernays. Okay, so this is what happened. The 1930s was kind of a shock bomb. It turns out the Hilbert program cannot work as given. So Gödel proved a series of theorems complete my series, which imply that if the ZFC is consistent, this means it has a realization, it has a model. Then it's not complete. Complete means that it can answer every question that's asked. So every sentence that can be formulated in the language of ZFC, is it true or false, as provable as ZFC. That was the idea of completeness that Hilbert wanted. But Gödel proved that you cannot have this for ZFC, and moreover, he proved this, that you cannot have this for anything reasonable at all. So if you have a recursive list of axioms, it can be inference, just recursively enumerable. And these axioms apply to piano arithmetics, so you want to be able to do induction. Your axioms will give you a system that has exactly this property. If it's consistent, then it's not complete. So things look really bad there from that point of view, right? If there is any realization of your system, then there is a sentence which you can not prove what is true. So this is true of any reasonable system, and somehow this looks like the end of the Hilbert program big time. Okay. And what's amazing enough about set theory is that, in fact, the witness for this incompleteness, a concrete witness, is provided by one of the first statements that was considered seriously in set theory, which is the continuum hypothesis. So Cantor obsessed about this continuum hypothesis, which says, is there something to write with?
I have it.
Oh, okay.
Please.
Great, thanks a lot. Okay, so what's the continuum hypothesis? In fact, there was a continuum hypothesis in mechanics before this one, but ours took over, and this is what you call continuum hypothesis. It was formulated by Cantor. So Cantor looked at the natural numbers, n, and he looked at the real numbers, and of course both of them are infinite sets, and he showed that they are not bijective. So there is no bijection between these two. Moreover, if you can look at some other sets like the rationals, irrationals, all kinds of sets, and he always was able to show if you take an infinite subset of the reals, anyone that he picked up, either it's bijective with R or with N. So the question becomes, can you find a subset of R which is infinite and is not bijective either with N or with R? And the statement that you cannot find such a set is not as a continuum hypothesis. It has many equivalent definitions, and it also can be framed in terms of the arithmetics of infinite cardinal numbers. It says the power set of N, which is known to be bijective with R, and which has size 2 to the power 0, is exactly the first cardinal number, which is uncountable, which means it's not bijective with N. So there is nothing between N and R. So that's the continuum hypothesis, and poor Cantor was driven to the mental asylum by this continuum hypothesis, because he first thought he proved it, then he realized he didn't prove it. And there were several people who thought about this. There were some quite nice moments. For example, the presentation of Koenig at an international congress where he claimed that Cantor was wrong and that he proved the continuum hypothesis. So there was lots of stuff that somehow went on for like 20 years. They couldn't find out if this continuum hypothesis is true or false. And amazingly enough, it turns out it's neither true or false in set theory. You cannot prove that it is true, or you cannot prove that it is false. It's just a specific witness for the incompleteness of ZFC axioms. And this follows from the work of Coyne in 1963, who introduced a method that he called forcing. And this method is basically this. If I give you a model of set theory, when I say set theory, I mean the axioms of ZFC, then I can turn that into another model, a little bit bigger. And in this one, the set theory is true, but the continuum can have any value you like, basically. All of 17, for example. So you can just violate this continuum hypothesis. You can also prove it. In some models, it is therefore false, and in some others, it's true. And hence, we have complicated.
Okay, so somehow this method of forcing was both very positive and very negative for set theory. So first, it was positive because it was so unusual to build new models of things of this kind. It's a very, there's a lot of logic going on. You know, we don't even know if we have one model. So it's kind of hard to understand this method when we see it first. And so calling that Fields method, people were excited about this. And then, you know, many people started working on this subject and proving that all kinds of statements are like this independent, as you said. We cannot show the truth or the falsity of these statements. And, you know, some of these statements come from analysis, some come from algebra, from various parts of mathematics, and it turned somehow for a long time that whatever you can say about uncountable objects is actually independent. So, you know, it was in a sense also a demise of set theory in some sense, because it started to look like that we shouldn't be looking at these objects because we cannot say anything about them. Well, of course, this is not at all the case, and the independence results are very interesting, and I want today to talk to you about some reason for it, which indicates that, you know, maybe this, the truth is not quite as bad as it looks. So what do I mean by this? So I'll make a picture here. This is our universe of set theory. So the universe of set theory is called V. And it's cumulative hierarchy. You start with the empty set. You then take all the subsets of the empty set that gives you V1. This was V0. You keep going at the limit stages, you take the union. So this is the universe of set theory, and in this universe there are some distinguished objects. These distinguished objects are the ordinals. So the ordinals, the first ordinals are 0, 1, 2, etc., 3, omega, omega plus 1. And some of these ordinals are cardinals. So the cardinals are those ordinals that are not bijective with any ordinal. So for example, these first few are cardinals, and this one is the cardinal, this one is not the cardinal because it's projected with omega. The next one is omega lambda. And as I just said, many statements about omega 1 have proved to be independent of set theory. For example, the statement you take a Boolean algebra that has a countable chain coefficient, so all the anti chains are countable. Take that Boolean algebra, the class of Boolean algebras, and ask yourself, is this property productive? So when we take two such things, do we still have the property that the product is CCC? A totally naive looking question, but that question is actually dependent on set theory. Or for example, the existence of a submeasure algebra, a Hahn algebra, that is not a measure algebra, is also independent. Existence of a Sussman tree, now I'm talking about objects that maybe not everybody has heard about. Okay, but these are said to be the combinatorial objects of omega 1. Very simple to define. Okay, so this looks like here we can do lots of stuff. How about omega 2? Well, actually, we have much fewer techniques about omega 2 than we have about omega 1. And we might get into this third part of the talk. But somehow the common belief is it should be the same thing. Okay, we should still have lots of independence. And then there should be no news on omega 3 and whatever. And then we keep going. So the next cardinal, when we have gone through all the omega n's, so they're each a successor of each other, is that omega omega. Or we call it aleph omega. So it's the limit of these things. Well, can we do whatever we like in those situations? I will now try to convince you that the ZFC axioms somehow catch their tail when they get this kind of problems.
These cardinals are called singular curves. What is singular about them? This is quite a huge guy. It's bigger than alpha 1, so it's bigger. It's not only uncountable, but it's really seriously uncountable. It's alpha 1, alpha 2, etc. So it's a big, big cardinal. But you can reach this cardinal by a sequence of rather short length. So it's a limit of omega 1, omega 2, omega 3. You just need omega many steps. So such cardinals are called singular. Their cofinality is the smaller size of the number of steps you need to reach them in a ring. And the cofinality is smaller than their size. And it turns out that ZFC actually has much less independence when it comes to such cardinals. It somehow catches its tail. Some things are just provable in ZFC about such cardinals. And this is quite an amazing effect. We'll talk about that, some other things as well. So I'll just put some questions here that are facing set theory today. So one question that I've alluded in this informal presentation is how important is the incoherence? Can we catch our tail somehow? Can we still have a picture of the universe? What's the universe? I don't know what people's philosophical beliefs are in this room. I'm deeply committed to platonist. For me, there is a universe of mathematics. I don't know if it has a 0-1 logic, if anything is true or false in it, maybe it has quantum logic, but there is a universe of mathematics, and the way that I see set theory is trying to model this universe of mathematics. So somehow, for me, all these incompleteness theorems say that, you know, well, we have our model, V, but mathematics is bigger than that, and we cannot reach it, well, you know, it's not such a great surprise. So we face this question in both mathematical and philosophical ways. And there's also a question of how far we are ready to go to avoid this incompleteness. For example, there is a heart of set theory. It's called L. It consists of constructible sets. What are constructible sets? Basically, constructible sets are those sets that you can define by formula. So if you are a working mathematician, basically any set you will ever see is a constructible set because you have constructed it in some way. So this is L. This is always present as a sum universe of any model of set. So you know already it's unique. So for example, if you are ready to only work with such sets, then many of these problems disappear completely. L calculates exactly the values of the cardinal exponentiation. It knows that 2 to the power of 0 is equal to alpha 1, etc. So, you know, this is quite a strong requirement to work only with the sets, but this is a possibility. There are finer theorems about this. For example, there is a lovely theorem of Jensen, which says that if your universe V is not too far from L, then somehow in your V, things are pretty close to what they were in L. This is called Jensen's covering lemma. And what this covering lemma says is that a certain statement called singular cardinal hypothesis, which I will give you the definition of, it's some sort of cardinal arithmetic statement about singular cardinals, is true if in V we don't have a very strong witness that V is far from L. What do I mean by strong witness? There are some objects called large cardinals. Costa talked yesterday, gave a very, very nice presentation. And this kind of the smallest large cardinal which cannot possibly exist in L is called zero sharp. And this zero sharp is kind of concrete witness that your universe is certainly not equal to L, because it gives, in terms of Costa's talk yesterday, it gives an elementary mapping from L to L, which if V and M are equal to each other, can exist. So the theorem of Jensen says that if you don't have this zero sharp in V, then the strong cardinal hypothesis, the singular cardinal hypothesis, is true. So somehow, now, this little version of cardinal arithmetic is not true, but then when we get to singular cardinals like alpha, then we catch up.
So are we happy to live without large cardinals? Probably not. So theorists are not. But you know, there were one thing about large cardinals. We know that we cannot prove their existence in the areas that you see. That's why we call large, for example. Maybe not quite called large, but one of the reasons we call large. But we might, you know, once have genius who's going to show that there are no others. And very suspicious that this will happen, but maybe the truth is that there are no large cardinals. This brings us to the next concern. What are good axioms? What do you want to assume as axioms? Do you want to assume that V is equal to L? Do you want to assume something less, that V is not equal to L, but there is no zero sharp? Or you want to assume that there are all kinds of large cardinals up to all the huge and all the rank to rank that Kostas was mentioning yesterday? No. Where do you want to sit? And do the good axioms answer the continuum hypothesis, for example? And I think one question that we have to ask all the time, how relevant are we to mathematics? So I think we shouldn't be inventing axioms that are not used in mathematics. And equally, we shouldn't hesitate to adopt axioms. These axioms can usefully use the mathematics to model things. And one should also remember that maybe the answer is not totally unique. In some areas, you model better with one model, and in some other areas, you need another model, like in physics. Your quantum phenomena are not modeled in the same way as your big universe. So, and how about our favorite system? Is it good or not? I like that of C, so I'd like to defend it on my next few slides. So my first part is going to be a defense of our good old feathers. So it is about singular cardinals, as I said. And the question is strange and singular the same thing? Somehow the word singular implies that these cardinals have something wrong with them. Or something. But in fact, it turns out from the point of view of cardinal arithmetic that these cardinals are quite nice in a sense. So, what's cardinal arithmetic that we just give you a crash lesson in this? It's easier to learn than the multiplication and addition in primary school because it's very simple. You know, there are only two operations basically in cardinal arithmetic. Because if you take two cardinals, kappa and lambda, you can multiply them or add them. And the answer is no, it depends. It's going to be the bigger one. I'm talking now about infinite cardinals. This doesn't work about finite ones. So the addition and multiplication do not really give us much excitement. So the only two operations that really classically define operations about cardinal numbers is the next. So this is the successor. The next above is called kappa plus. And the size of the power set of kappa, which is called 2 to the kappa. And we know that these, both of these are clearly larger than kappa. And we also know that 2 to the kappa is always greater equal than kappa plus, following from this. So the question that is known as generalized hypothesis is that for all kappa, 2 to kappa is equal to kappa plus. So that something generalized on this thing. Because this one says 2 to the other 0 is equal to other 0 plus. And one can study various versions of this statement. And this singular cardinal hypothesis of which I talked about is an instance. So we'll talk about that singular cardinal hypothesis. And you know, everybody knows that the combinatorics of singular cardinals is strange. So now we're going to defend it, as I said, to see if it's really strange or not. And we shall be interested not only in singular cardinals, but also in their successors. Well, our thesis is that the set of C actually provides a good basis for studying the region of singular cardinals and their successors, in the sense that there isn't too much independence. There is a little bit of independence, but there are some bounds. And how big are these bounds is a very interesting open question. So let me give you some properties of singular cardinals which make them different than the regular cardinals. So
So there is this phenomenon which is called singular cardinal compactness. So some of you might have heard of the famous Whitehead problem. So the Whitehead problem is about finding groups that are not free, but their smaller subgroups are all free. So the smaller subgroup can be generated without any equations, but the whole big subgroup cannot. It's called the Whitehead group, and the existence of such a group of size out of one was a big old question that was resolved by Simon Scheller using set theory. He showed that this is an event. But he showed that when you go to a singular cardinal, you cannot get such an example. So if you take a singular cardinal, any group that's almost free, it means of every subgroup of smaller size is free, it's also free. And this is not only for groups, it's for a rather large class of objects. So at singulars, we have this phenomenon, which I think for students is something that hasn't been completely explored. He has this very nice general definition of freeness, which I don't think was worked on sufficiently. Okay. Then there are some principles, okay, so let me just say for those who do not know, L, in this universe L, there are some very nice combinatorial principles. So not only the GCH holds, but also some things which are nicer than GCH holds, some, you know, existence of some nice objects which have nice properties. For example, the square that I wrote here, square is on a kappa, is a sequence like this, C alpha, alpha limit, less than kappa plus, and what you have is that C alpha is a cloud. In alpha, the order type of C alpha is at most kappa, and they agree, they are cohere, so if beta is a limit point of C alpha, then C beta is a C alpha intersected with beta. Is there some eraser here, by the way? Oh, yeah, here. Okay, so that's a square. And this principle is very much related to the existence of large cardinals. And for example, if you want to know if your universe has some large cardinals, you can use this principle as a test. So there is, using inner model theory, one can prove that in the absence of large cardinals, this principle holds for all singular kappa. So for all singular kappa, unless we have large cardinals, we are actually there in some sense. And to kill a very weak version of this, which is equivalent to the existence of a special Aronsheim tree size kappa plus, we need a wooden cardinal. So we need to buy the large cardinal. Okay, then I promised you the statement of the singular cardinal hypothesis. So it has several different equivalent formulations. I chose the one which I think is the simplest to explain. The point of the statement is to say that at singular cardinals, the cardinal element is determined with what happens before. So for example, with the break of coin here in 4C, you can have take any number of regular cardinals you like, and you can, as Kunin says, monkey around the powers of regular cardinals. You can have, for example, a universe V which satisfies that 2 to the Aleph 0 is Aleph 17, and 2 to the Aleph 1 is Aleph omega 1 plus 1 plus 35, something like that. Okay, you can do whatever you like, and not only with two candidates, with any, even plus many, preserving some basic requirements, which I don't want. So you can do what you like. But this one says that at singular cardinals, actually what you do depends on what you have done before. So you see here, the value of 2 to the Aleph 1 has nothing to do with the value of 2 to the Aleph 0. You can change them independently. Now this hypothesis says that if you have for kappa singular cardinal, that's 2 to the cofinality kappa. Remember, being singular means that cofinality kappa is less than kappa. So this smaller cardinal, 2 to that is less than kappa. Then basically you can say how much is 2 to kappa. To the extent that the most important information about 2 to kappa is contained in kappa to cofinality kappa. And this has to be. So this is the statement, and what do we know about it? It's not true in ZFC, and it's actually not easy to show that it's not true in ZFC. It's, you know, to show that such things are not true, you would use some forcing argument. But because there is this Jensen coupling lemma, which I told you that if you don't have a large kernel, that this holds, if you want to live to violate this, then your argument has to include some large kernels. So for this kind of argument, we have to use both large kernels and forcing. And for it to violate this SCH, Magidor provided a model, which was the PhD thesis of Magidor, one of the most legendary and beautiful papers in set theory, in which he proved that it's possible not to have singular kernel hypothesis. And then in a series of papers, it was worked out what you actually need, and we took this very bold proof that the exact consistency strength of the statement is that you need a measurable kernel which has Mitchell ordering to couple up plus. So I already told you about Jensen's theorem. So SCH holds a theorem of large kernels. And it's also true that if you go above a very, you take something called the supercompact kernel, another player in Costa's talk yesterday, it turns out that the supercompact kernel somehow influences the universe above it. So you can say many things above the supercompact kernel. And one of them is that the universe above the supercompact kernel satisfies SCH. And what's also interesting, that a popular business in set theory is to add an axiom which is obtained by forcing. So these forcing axioms, the most popular one I think is Martin axiom. Analysis, certainly know about Martin axiom. For set theory, the most popular one is proper forcing axiom. But a proper forcing axiom, for example, implies that 2 to the other 0 is equal to out of 2. And these axioms are about out of 1. So Todorcevic and Milichkovic prove that PFA implies 2 to the other 0 equal to out of 2. And I here gave some stronger axioms than M and weaker axioms, MRT, and it turns out that all of those imply the singular kernel hypothesis. It is kind of strange, because they talk about alpha 1, but they imply the singular kernel hypothesis. It's also not so strange, because they are usually obtained by taking a model in which we have a supercompact and collapsing the supercompact. At some point, alpha 2 becomes supercompact. But it's not known if this is the only way to obtain models of this. So, look at this theorem. I think this is a curve. No, you cannot but be optimistic. You know, Coyne can do what he likes with his 2 to the other zeros, other ones, whatever. But what we have in this theorem, it says that if we do not do too much wild dancing, it's 2 to the other 10. So every 2 to the other 10 is less than alpha omega, and 2 to the other omega is actually bounded in ZFC. Okay, the bound is not particularly interesting. It's a cardinal alpha omega 4. It's a big cardinal. It's a bound. So somehow it says that this singular cardinal hypothesis, although no, it's not true in ZFC, to some extent it is. So this theorem, due to Shellac in 1980s, was discovered using another new cardinal arithmetics. He introduced two operations of cardinal arithmetics called pseudo-power and pseudo-coffinality in a theory known as PCF theory, and proved this theory. Okay, so this is all great. Have you been listening enough to the cardinal arithmetic, I'm wondering? Are you asking yourself, is in set theory anything else? Is there anything else in set theory but cardinal arithmetic? Well, let me put you at ease. That's exactly what I want to talk about. Something a little bit more combinatorial than just cardinal arithmetic. So I'm going to show you some theorems now, which indicate that not only Shellac's theorem is true, but actually all kinds of combinatorial properties of singular cardinals can be determined. I'm going to talk about this simple property of graphs. Okay, so what's a graph? A graph, an object very useful in everyday life, is an object which records relations among objects. So you have some bunch of objects. You can think of them as telephones or people or numbers, whatever, and you record which two of them are connected. And that gives you a graph. So for example, this is a graph. And what we would like to know in this problem of universality of graphs, we would like to look at the relation when one graph embeds into another. So we have some function f such that it preserves the relation of edges and the relation of non-edges. So for example, this graph here embeds into a bigger graph like this with the obvious effect. So the kinds of things that we look for in set theory is you have a class of graphs of fixed cardinality, and you would like to know in the universality context what's the smallest number, smallest family, such that you can embed all the graphs into at least one element of this family. So that's the universality. And we'll be interested only in uncountable cardinals. Take a cardinal quadrant to the ninth one, and we consider embeddings like this, which preserve edges and non-edges. Call this graph G, this one H. So this context G is less equal than H. So you can think of this as some sort of quasi-ordinate class of graphs. And we are interested in the smallest size of the dominating families. So we're looking for all the graphs of a certain size kappa. And now U kappa is the smallest size of the universal family, the dominating family. So it's some subfamily of this kind. You take the small subfamily as the property that all the graphs of size kappa can embed into at least one of those elements of the universal family. We're looking for the smallest cardinal by this process. And it turns out that this question is not particularly interesting if you have GCH, because by modern theory, classical model theory involving saturated and special models, you can show that if GCH holds, then this number is just one. So there's always one universal graph. Well, now you can start playing around. What happens when you don't have GCH? So let's first look at some results at the first interesting cardinal, the Calif 1, or successor of regular cardinals, which look like Calif 1. So it turns out that just with coenforcing, you can easily get this number to be as large as possible. So the number of graphs of size kappa up to isomorphisms is 2 to the kappa. So this number is at most as big as 2 to the kappa and at least as big as 1. So this number here, uk, in the Cohen models is the biggest possible, 2 to the kappa. Now, it's also consistent to have to separate these numbers. By U to kappa can be less than 2 to kappa, and yet larger than kappa plus. So this was done by Mecker and Shellac independently in two different papers, especially recommending the one by Mecker, very nice paper, in which he used CCC forcing to show the consistency of this analysis. Now with Shellac, we have a paper in which we speak a more general statement, which applies also to other classes. So, now what happens with successors of singulars? I want to show you now that you cannot play this game with a success of a singular. Well, let's see first how far you can play this game. So, basically, if you have SCH, your cards are already played for you, the universality number is going to be able to find. So, what I'm talking about, I have this kappa, kappa is singular. And now I'm looking at graphs in kappa plus. And I want to know their universality. So basically the same argument which says GCH is one universal also tells you that if you have SCH, this question will be one universal. So if you want to get consistent results, consistency results when this number is larger than 1, you better violate SCH, and so therefore you would have to take these models, which I told you were somewhat difficult, of Magidor and whatever, and, you know, at least that's at the starting point. So, the first result in this context was obtained by Shellac and myself in 2005. We worked for the lambda is here the cardinality of kappa. So we we obtained the consistency of the following statement for countable cardinality, and then in very recent work with five illustrious authors that have been writing this paper for years, and one of them is a joint point between your and my university. So we got this result in the joint work with Cummings, Magidor, Morgan, Shella, and myself. The statement is the following. If you allow yourself the luxury of having a supercompact partner, which will very much help you to violate SCH, you take lambda less than kappa, a regular cardinal, and you take any large enough cardinal theta if you want, larger equal than kappa plus 3, with cofinality larger equal than kappa double plus, then there is a cardinal preserving forcing extension in which, what do we get? We get the cofinality of this kappa to be lambda, so kappa becomes singular. 2 to the kappa is equal to 2 to the kappa plus is equal to this theta, so you can make it whatever you like. But the universality number is bound. It's bounded by kappa plus 2. So this guy, 2 to the kappa plus, could be, if you want, kappa plus a million. But this one is less or equal than kappa plus 2. So this result corresponds to the result of Jamun and Shellac, which I mentioned before for successes today. Let me briefly show you, you know, just to pretend to be impressed, how the proofs of these things work. Just to indicate to the students how one would approach this kind of problem. So some ideas of the proofs. So what we need to do here, we start with kappa. And this kappa is going to be, at the end, singular. So in fact, what we're going to do is to make an iteration where we consider in this iteration of forcing all graphs of size kappa plus. But all graphs of size kappa plus, not only at the end of the iteration, but at the end of the collapsing forcing. So in this forcing, we're going to use rating forcing to change the cofinality of kappa to equal 1. And this is in this final universe that we want to control our graphs. So we put here a huge list of names, which are just graphs that will appear at the end of this story. So some list of names. And we have to look at those names in this iteration, and we hope to catch up our tape. So in this long bit, at each step we're looking at one graph, and we somehow embedding it into this future universe. We want the big article wants to bed, we do this in iteration. However, we also have, for this result to be interesting, we have to make 2 to the kappa large, 2 to the kappa plus large, but we actually make 2 to the kappa large. So at the, all the time, we're adding subsets to kappa to make this. Here we start with 2 to the kappa is equal to kappa plus or whatever, and we build the time. And the problem is that if we are doing this, then for those in the know, gradient forcing actually asks you to have a sequence of extenders of kappa, or, you know, some measures of kappa. If you want to think of the simplest case of countable cofinality, you can think of prickly forcing. So the prickly forcing works by taking a measure of kappa. A measure is some family of subsets of kappa, such that each subset is either in or out. It's an ultrafilter. But this ultrafilter that exists here is never going to exist before. Because all the time you're adding new subsets to kappa. So whatever looks like an ultrafilter to a naive observer at this point is not an ultrafilter again. Because the new subsets of kappa are not going to be controlled by it. So you've got a problem here to what you do with those subsets that are not controlled. Well, so what you do is that you build this outer field graph of course. mathematical forcing, you build it as a part of the process. So it's part of the process, not only that you are controlling those names, not only that you are adding subsets, but you're also building your outer filter. That's important because this outer filter is going to control those names. You cannot know these names before you have the outer filter. So in fact, at each point, you have kind of an outer filter. And then at the end, you take the union of those approximations. I'll just call it the union. It's a little bit more complicated than that. And the names that do exist with you are predicted by this. So you have this double prediction. So that was the idea of my paper with Cella, and then much more involved with the rate enforcing. So this is what I mean in rate enforcing with respect to what substance of kappa all the time. And we construct the measures as we go. And then the universal family is we take a final sequence of graphs in lambda. So in fact, in this model, the cofinality of lambda is going to be. Okay, so now I said I would leave the slides for Samuel to put somewhere for the students. But this iteration of forcing looks like this. Of course, no time to read all of this. But this just has an element which is building this measure, which is this element. And then it has also an element which is building universality. So you build this universality using a tree. You use the LNTAP topology. And you have this important requirement which allows you to actually deal with names rather than the graphs themselves. So, no reason to try to read all of this, but it will be on the slides. And then if you get interested, the paper will soon be available and submitted, I hope. Okay, so with Cummings and Morgan, we have another project in which we actually can make this singular cardinal to be on the phone. Great, so this kind of shows there is some independence at singular cardinals. Well, this is a point. This is the point I want to make. The point I want to make is that for all we know, we don't even have more than one universal graph at this point. So we know how to make it small, but we don't know how small we get. We don't know how to control it. And here's a question for you. Can we make this number big? Every baby can do this. For aleph 1, aleph 2, whatever. It's the simplest forcing ever, the coin forcing. But there is no coin forcing in this instance. So we don't know how to solve this. And my suspicion is that all this actually indicates that there is some set of C combinatorics available at the success of the C. You know, things that we cannot do by forcing. So actually, that's not just that SCH is true, but much more. The combinatorial properties of those couples are there to explore. Okay, I prepared here another universality problem, which is about even more striking in some sense. But I will leave it with Samuel. I won't go into it right now. Now, I'll just briefly say that this universality problem is about trees of size kappa with no kappa branches. These trees are used in computer science as well, but with successors of singulars or singular cardinals. But these kind of trees are used as clocks of Ehrenfried Fresnel games. So very relevant, this universality problem comes from that perspective. So this is kind of the next computer science. And there are some surprising ZFC results available for the singular cardinals. This is from the work that I've done with Dr. Vananen. And a very beautiful open question, aleph 1. So you can see all of that on the slides. Let me go to the conclusion. Cardinal invariants. So the cardinal invariants at aleph 1, we have discussed this. The size of the power set of aleph 0. Basically, the cardinal invariants at aleph 1 are you take the structure omega to omega. So the functions from the natural numbers to themselves. They represent the real numbers. All the properties of real numbers you can code in this structure when you look at the structure modulo eventual domination. So f is less or equal than g, if eventually f of n is less than g. And so you can look for all kinds of cardinals associated to this structure. For example, the analog of this universality number is called the dominating D. And, you know, basically for every letter there is a cardinal invariant, probably too many of them, but there are some classical ones which are well defined, and they are called A, B, C, D. D, I just defined, C is 2 to the other 0. And, you know, the forcing technology of Alekhine allows us to differentiate these. And basically, the nicest theorems that we have about forcing technology, they are motivated by this kind of questions. So, you know, for example, to get A less than B is a difficult forcing question. Now, I claim we could look at the same thing as a singular cardinal, or its successor. What are the combinatorial properties of this object? We can define the cardinal number. And I think that we are not going to be able to understand the dependency. I think we are going to prove some set of zero sets. So, the two examples, the second one I have represented, show that invariants are generally different than what happens at alpha. So we have a generally different strategy, and I think this should be studied systematically. So I think that will make a fantastic piece of project. And what kind of combinatorial properties can we obtain just in set of C? And, well, you know, not everything can be done. Of course, you know, SCH can fail, so this can be only relative results, like the one that I just mentioned. But, and also there are combinatorial results which show that some of these guys can be made as large as possible. Like in a paper of Cummings and Sherlock, there is a result that for every kappa you get, that every Kungulan algebra is the largest possible number of subalgebras. Okay, so that was supposed to be the first part of my talk. Of course, we are thinking of this lovely lunch that's waiting for me, so please don't feel that I will, you know, going on forever. But I do want to tell you something else, something that's very relevant here, very often. So I want to talk to you about connections between set theory and other subjects of mathematics. This is a favorite of mine. When I learned set theory, it was from a book which I'm pretty sure nobody in this room knows. Because that book was written in several crafts by a man called Juro Kureka, who is known to set theorists for Kureka trees and for his very consistent problem. But he also wrote a lovely book on set theory, which was just called set theory. But in fact, in this book, there was set theory, topology, and measure theory. So in his mind, this was all the same subject. And, you know, I think I was perhaps too influenced by this book, but in my mind, this is still the same subject. I think set theory is very deeply involved in analysis of the measure theory, for topology, and other subjects as well. But these are the ones that I want to refer to. And I think this is very important, because it is important for a foundational subject to actually live in accordance with the world that it's supposed to model. So, in the case of set theory, we should be living close to mathematics. And we really have had enormous interactivity with about every subject of mathematics. And I would like to mention two people working in this department, Samuel and Marcello, who are working between the subjects, topology and set theory. And it turns out, actually, I knew their PhD, a common PhD at Montserrat. He was a PhD student. So it's a long tradition of somehow virtual. Okay, so this is their very somehow bridge between topology and set theory. So for those students entering this newly organized PhD program, you know, there is a lot of possibility in this kind of things. Yesterday we discussed with Kostas and Samuel, for you who were there, we discussed some connections actually between Kostas and this kind of thing. Okay. Now I will present, I will say a few words about one topic which has been close to my mind. It involves, what's interesting about this guy is that it involves also model theory. So it's a topic between model theory, set theory, and Banach space theory. And it's about universality of finite spaces and the isomorphisms. So to make the long story short, isomorphism between Banach spaces doesn't preserve Detmoni properties. So if you have an isomorphism, you know what this means. It will generally not preserve isometry. It is not an isometry in general. So it's kind of difficult to model. And questions of the existence of the universal Banach space of a given density have been on the list of subjects considered by Banach space theorists for a long time. So this is the definition of universality, which is in this context as well. So I'm not defined it, just to remind you, this is what it means in isomorphic then in Banach spaces. So T is isomorphic if you can bound the norm of T of X below and above by some constant. And it's isometric if this constant is actually bounded. And then, you know, Banach space theorists consider all kinds of embeddings, like a positive embedding, which is isomorphism, plus positive operators, f, positive functions, go into positive functions. Or order preserving embeddings. So we have f is less or equal than g, but the t of f is less or equal than g. Or, you know, isomorphic embeddings, which have a bound on this c. All kinds of embeddings, and they all turned out to be quite interesting. So these questions follow a classical theory and also some modern theory. So classical people in the subject, Banach, 1930s, Bourgon, Schlenk, modern people, here's a Brazilian person, Brech, Cristina Brech, and Piotr Kosmider, who worked for some years in Sao Paulo, Brech is in Sao Paulo. Then I mentioned here, Jerusalem, Shabbat, and Switzerland, and some of the Paris, the Old Church, Paris, and Canada. And the most interesting class of Banach spaces are those that are of the form C of K. So we take a compact space, and you look at the continuous functions from this compact space into K. That gives you Banach space with a natural norm, which is the supreme norm function. And one actually can concentrate on. You can define point-wise addition and multiplication. And it turns out that the isomorphic theory of these spaces is quite different than the isometric theory. The second isomorphic should be isometric. So some results here is that if you preserve a little bit more than isometry, actually, it characterizes your K. So a lovely result which connects topology and Banach spaces. So for example, an early theorem, Banach, the Stone theorem, if T is an isometry, and C of K goes onto C of L by an isometry, then K of L actually is a homeomorphic. Gelfand and Kolmogorov in 1939, the same if you preserve also multiplication. You are isometric, but you preserve multiplication. And the theorem of Poplansky, if you preserve order, then this is the case. And the theorem that is less, the two theorems that are less known, but very beautiful theorems, by Amir and Campbell, by dependence, that if you have an isomorphic quantum embedding, which has a bounded norm, bounded by two, then it actually preserves the topological structure. So the question is now, what if you drop this onto? So you want to have embeddings like you have some graphs, but now these are not graphs, these are Banach spaces, and between these Banach spaces we have a kind of isomorphic embedding, and we're looking for the same number, this universality. Just what can you say about that? Well, actually you can translate everything question of Boolean algebras, and only work by Stone with C of spaces that are Stone spaces on the Boolean algebra. And so what you can observe, when should I start?
Now. About 10 minutes.
10 minutes, okay, great. So some nice results. Every Banach space of density kappa isometric embeds into one of the form of C of the stone space of A of the same density. So if you're looking for universal families, then you might as well be just looking into these black spaces, because all the others are embedded to the negative. And then there is a connection between Boolean algebra and Banach spaces, in the sense that if you have an embedding between A and B, then you have an embedding between C of the stone space of B into C of the stone space of B. Why is this nice? Well, this is a first order object. You can do something in Boolean algebra, it's a force. It's a first order easy transform. This guy's continuous functions, complicated. So it's much easier to work with Boolean algebra. And this kind of result is very helpful. So if we now denote the class of Boolean algebra and look at the angle of its elevation, we get the following corollary. Universality number of the class of Boolean of Banach spaces of density kappa under isomorphisms is certainly less or equal than the universality number of the same class under isometries. And this is by this result less or equal than the universality number of the Boolean algebras. Here is a million-dollar question: can you separate these numbers? For uncountable kappa, we don't have even a single model which can separate these three numbers. Let me just give you some non-theorems to get you warmed up about this question. Now, here is a classical question about isometries in separable spaces. Separable means not density. C of 0, 1 is isometrically universal for separable Banach spaces. You just find it very natural. Classical model theory, well, classical model theory which we mentioned before works for any first order structure. So for any first order structure, you have one universal element at every uncountable curve under GCH. So we have this Boolean algebra, and from the inequality I showed you, this means that you also have a four Banach spaces. So if you are willing to accept GCH, the result will be this problem. But if you want to know what happens in the absence of GCH, the question is, can you have 2 to the kappa large and the universality number small for Banach spaces? Here is a very nice theorem, Parobchenko from 1951. This particular Boolean algebra P of omega mod finite, so you take all subsets of omega and you equate 2 if they only differ finitely many, that gives you Boolean algebra, and under CH, it is a universal Boolean algebra for the Boolean algebras of size alpha. Now you go through this game of taking the stone space and then C of it. So C of the stone space of P of omega mod finite, which happens to be isomorphic to L infinity mod 0, is actually universal on the C, Banach space of density alpha. This is a lovely work of Greg Kozmiller, in which David wanted to know what happens to the Boolean model. So there is a geometrically universal Banach space of density continuum. So this is kind of surprising because we already know that Cohen reals, adding Cohen reals destroys universality. And it destroys it. I actually have a theorem that says that if you add one Cohen real, destroy universality. But what this says, universality at Aleph 1. But they're not looking at Aleph 1, they're looking at the continuum, which is Aleph 2 in this one. And they show surprisingly enough that in this model there is a universal space of density out of 2. And what is really interesting, it's not the one you would think, it's not the usual suspect. You would think it's this one, because we have learned that it's universal. But it's not. It's not even isomorphic universal. So it's a very nice result. And it's also the paper which we haven't followed. We proved that this is true in other kinds of Cohen models. Okay, so there are some negative results. So there is a big theory, model theory, about classification of first order theories. So you have stable theories, unstable theories, and some other levels. And the idea is that if the theory is stable or unstable, can be told by the number of pairwise non-isomorphic models that the DoD has at uncounted currents. So this is a big project called classification theory that was started by Morningstier in 1965 and which culminated in this fantastic book by Simon Shellach, in which he gave actually complete theorem connecting these two seemingly unrelated properties. So it turns out that through some work that we done with Shellach and other people, Luke has done centered around Shellach, that the universality problem has some connections with classification of model theory. So somehow when you look for those unstable theories, the majority of theories are stable in the classification project. Now you want to classify them in the good guys and the bad guys somehow. And it turns out that the universal number of universal elements provides a good classification. So it's a project which I won't quote anything. But in this classification, the worst guys are the linear orders. They have, as soon as you move away enough from GCH, linear orders have the largest possible universality. This is a result of Koizumi and Shellach. And in fact, they proved that this works for any theory that, any first order theory that has the strict order property, which is the case of Boolean algebras. So they calculated, therefore, that this universality number of Boolean algebras is large. So you might wonder now, thinking of our inequality that we're trying to solve there. What is my inequality? Yeah, this inequality, we're trying to separate these three numbers, the three numbers at top bottom. And you know, Koizumi and Shellach show that this one is, as soon as you move enough from GCH, this one is the biggest possible. So does that work for this one? Now it turns out that Kuznetsov and Shellach showed that it does work for isometric. So in fact, they showed that Koizumi-Shellach theorem is true, but for isometric values. Ever since seeing that theorem, I was obsessed by saying, yes, this must be true for isomorphic values. And I put some 3-4 years of work in this, and I actually proved that indeed, it is true also for isomorphic embeddings. But unfortunately, I have to cheat a little bit, and I have to ask my embedding be somewhat special. Okay, so let me just show you how to keep the coin model. Okay, so here's the net result of my several years of work. Here's this theorem. If you take isomorphic embeddings that are in addition positive, which is a property that is studied in Banach space theory, and they have two other rather threshold properties which I might discuss here, but we don't have time, then we have exactly the analog of the property of the result of the transformation. And let me just say, why did it take this long time to show this theorem? Because the model theoretic properties that were used in the break of Kuznetsov and Shellach don't work at all in this context. Here we really have to keep the continuous functions, and their context is for first order theories. And none of the continuous model theory doesn't work at all here. So we had to invent a context, a model theoretic context, in which we were able to model the continuous functions by model theoretic objects, first order kind of first order. That's something that I call natural spaces. And this theorem is about 20 minutes. Okay, so let me now finish up there. Let me just say that I think you understand what the questions, open questions are in the subject. The open question is, can you please get rid of 2 and 3 in this, 1, 2, and 3 in this theorem? Can you prove this theorem? But more importantly, the open question is, can you show that this inequality, the set of inequalities that I showed you there in this slide, is actually true as I have seen it? conjecture. Can you show this conjecture? All possible forcing models that I've tried satisfy this. And then nobody else has tried it. This is a good chance. This is a Z of C2. It should be very interesting. Let's see what else is on the menu of this talk. There was a third part which I don't know already if we're going to go into this. I'll just give you the title. It's about forcing axioms. Forcing axioms are okay. As I said before, these are things like MN, PFA, R-transform. Forcing axioms, they mostly talk about constructing objects of size alpha 1. There's a lot of activity at the moment about forcing axioms for constructing objects of alpha 2. Very exciting activity. I believe there are some ZFC results that show that we cannot have too much of a forcing axiom. So for those in the know, if you want to have an analog of proper forcing axiom with alpha 2, then to have the proper forcing axiom with alpha 1, this is provably possible. So the theorem of Shemaki says that if you want to have a forcing axiom for forcing that preserves both stationary subsets of omega 1 and omega 2, it's a chemistry. But you can have some analog. Okay, this is a big theory right now. Very important. Okay. Let's see, is there anything here that I still want to say? I think that I'll just quickly run through this to see if there's anything that I've forgotten. And also, I don't know how to move on the side here. We've done this. Okay, so I think that now it's time for me to stop this talk. You will have the concrete slides with Samuel. I would very much like to talk to you guys. And I'm looking now for the slide that I wrote about practical things. So please let me click for, you know, 30 slides or so to get to this practical slide in which I want to talk to you about things that we can do together. Like, it's really important. Okay, that's the last one. Opportunities for you. Well, okay, several years ago we founded something called the European Set Theory Society. It has the word European in it because we asked money from the European agencies, and they very much like that you call ourselves European, but it has members from everywhere in the world. Very much hope that some of you will consider becoming our members. PhD students can join us for free. The rest of you can join us for 20 euros a year. Or those who are unemployed can also join us for free. Those who are retired can join us for free. And you know, the least important thing is this membership fee. I'd like to have as many centurists in one place as possible. And the purpose of our organization is to facilitate interactions between centurists in the world, to establish our subject among other mathematical subjects, to continue to showcase it, to obtain funding, to have conferences, etc. So this is actually the newest thing about our society. We have become an associate member of the European Mathematical Society. We are the only one which is not connected to any country. So we don't have a country, we just have the set. We have, you know, London Mathematical Society, French Mathematical Society, Indian, whatever, not Indian. Italian are members of the European Mathematical Society, so it's European Set Theory Society. So we live in our country called Set Theory. In old Russian times it was called Lusitania, if you know history of Lusin. And this European Set Theory Society also has some activities. For example, we are involved in something called Young Set Theory Meetings. So every year we organize a huge meeting, which is not organized only by us, but by other organizations as well, in which there are maybe 60 students, and we have something like what you have here, a week of talks, lots of exercises, lots of interaction between young people, and lots of new ideas come up to say. Then, okay, in Europe, to be honest, we have a serious problem that we have too few jobs in mathematics in general. When I say jobs, permanent jobs. One of the hopes that we have in our society is to improve this. However, we do have postdocs. Not always easy to get, but they exist, and some of them are not limited to Europeans. So that's another occasion that you might choose to perhaps come to us. We have visiting positions. We are applying now for a grant from the European Research Council, which hopefully will give us a lot of PhD positions. So any of you, there are numbers of you who might like to come and visit for 6 months, maybe as part of your PhD, we hope to be able to fund such things. And helping all this great government that we have in Brazil, which we want to celebrate, has done some. The reason I know that there is actually that I know that they have put a lot of funding in science, which I think is a fantastic thing. And some of this funding is also for young people. So I hope that these things will help us to collaborate. And most importantly, that would be very interesting to collaborate with Guatemala and people from distance. So please feel free to continue this talk over coffee or over a dinner. Thank you very much. So I'm